Penguin Random House Audio presents Dear Committee Members by Julie Schumacher. Read for you by Robertson Dean. September 3, 2009, Bentham Literary Residency Program, Post Office Box 1572, Bentham, Maine, 04976. Dear Committee Members, over the past 20-odd years, I have recommended God only knows how many talented candidates for the Bentham January Residency, that enviable literary oasis in the woods south of Skowhegan, the solitude, the pristine cabins, the artistic camaraderie, and those exquisite hand-delivered satchels of apples and cheese. Well, you can scratch all prior nominees and pretenders from your mailing lists, because none is as provocative or as promising as Darren Browles. Mr. Browles is my advisee. He's taken two of my workshops, and his novel in progress, a retelling of Melville's Bartleby, but in which the eponymous character is hired to keep the books at a brothel circa 1960 just outside Las Vegas, is both tender satire and blistering adaptation homage. In brief, this tour de force is witty, incisive, original, brutally sophisticated, erotic. You don't need me to summarize it. You'll have received his two opening chapters. My agent, Ken Doyle, is apprised of the project and is gnashing his pearly incisors in the hope of receiving the completed manuscript soon. Any additional perks or funding you can provide for Browles during the residency will be appreciated. He's likely to be wooed by editors all over New York. A personal aside, I was very sorry to hear of Mike's death. He was a terrific director, and I always enjoyed talking to him in the row of blue rocking chairs out on the porch during the occasions, too rare, when I was able to escape my academic duties here in the Midwest and accept his invitations to Bentham. He'll be terribly hard to replace. Whoever tries to step into them will find he wore sizable, generous shoes. In sadness, but looking to the future, Jason T. Fitger, Professor of Creative Writing and English, Department of English, Payne University. September 4, 2009. Theodore Boti, Chair, Department of English. Dear Ted, your memo of August 30th requests that we on the English faculty recommend some luckless colleague for the position of Director of Graduate Studies. You may have been surprised to find this position vacant upon your assumption of the chairship last month. If so, trust me, you will encounter many such surprises here. A quick aside, Ted. God knows what enticements were employed during the heat of summer to persuade you, a sociologist, to accept the position of chair in a department not your own, an academic unit whose reputation for eccentricity and discord has inspired the upper echelon to punish us by withholding favors as if from a six-year-old at a birthday party. No raises or research funds for you, you ungovernable rascals, and no fudge before dinner. Perhaps, as the subject of a sociological study, you will find the problem of our dwindling status intriguing. To the matter at hand. Though English has traditionally been a largish department, you will find there are very few viable candidates capable of assuming the mantle of DGS. In fact, if I were a betting man, I'd wager that only 10% of the English instruction list will answer your call for nominations. Why? First, because more than a third of our faculty now consists of temporary adjunct instructors who creep into the building under cover of darkness to teach their graveyard shifts of freshman comp. They are not eligible to vote or to serve. Second, because the remaining two-thirds of the faculty, bearing the scars of disenfranchisement and long-term abuse, are busy tending to personal grudges like scraps of carrion on which they gnaw in the gloom of their offices. Long story short, your options aren't pretty. After subtracting the names of those who are on leave or close to retirement and those already serving in the killing fields of administration, you will probably be forced to choose between Franklin Cantrell. No. Spend five consecutive minutes with him, and you will understand why. Jennifer Brown Wilson, a whipping girl for the theory faction, already terrorized, she will decline. Albert Tyne, Under no circumstances should you enter his office without several days' warning. More on this later. Donna Lovejoy, poor overworked creature, I hereby nominate her, anonymously, please, with this letter, and me. You'll soon find that I make myself unpleasant enough to be safe from nomination. Enfin, Lovejoy will sag under this additional burden, but she will perform. Ted, in your memo, you referred briefly also to the need for faculty forbearance during what we were initially told would be the remodeling of the second floor for the benefit of our colleagues in the economics department. Under whose aegis was it decided that economics and English should share a building? Were criteria other than the alphabet considered? I'm not sure that you noticed, but the econ faculty were, in early August, evacuated from the building, as if they'd been notified, sotto voce, of an oncoming plague. Not so the faculty in English. With the exception of a few individuals both fleet of foot and quick-witted enough to claim status as asthmatics, we have been left behind, almost biblically, expected to begin our classes and meet with students while bulldozers snarl at the door. Yesterday afternoon, during my multicultural American literature class, I watched a wrecking ball swinging like a hypnotist's watch just past the window. While I am relieved to know that the economists, delicate creatures, have been safely installed in a wing of the new geology building where their physical comfort and aesthetic needs can be addressed, those of us who remain as castaways here in Willard Hall risk not only deafness but mutation. As of next week, we have been instructed to keep our windows tightly closed due to particulate matter. But my office window, here's the amusing part, Ted, no longer shuts. One theory here. The deanery is annoyed with our requests for parity and, weary of waiting for us to retire, has decided to kill us. Let the academic year begin. Cordially, and with a hearty welcome to the madhouse, Jay. September 9, 2009. Mary Alice Ingersoll, Manager, Wexler Foods, Inc., 65409 Capitol Drive, Maplewood, Minnesota, 55109. Dear Ms. Ingersoll, this letter is intended to bolster the application to Wexler Foods of my former student, John Lisinski, who completed the junior-senior creative writing workshop 3 months ago. Mr. Lisinski received a final grade of B, primarily on the basis of an 11-page short story about an inebriated man who tumbles into a cave and surfaces from an alcoholic stupor to find that a tentacled monster, a sort of fanged and copiously salivating octopus, if memory serves, is gnawing through the flesh of his lower legs, the monster's spittle burbling ever closer to the victim's groin. Though chaotic and improbable, even within the fantasy horror genre, the story was solidly constructed. Dialogue consisted primarily of agonized groans and screaming. The chronology was relentlessly clear. Mr. Lisinski attended class faithfully, arriving on time, and rarely succumbed to the undergraduate impulse to check his cell phone for messages or relentlessly zip and unzip his backpack in the final minutes of class. Whether punctuality and an enthusiasm for flesh-eating cephalopods are the main attributes of the ideal Wexler employee, I have no idea, but Mr. Lisinski is an affable young man, reliable in his habits, and reasonably bright. You might start him off in produce, rather than seafood or meats. Whimsically, Jason T. Fitger, Professor of Creative Writing, English, Payne University. September 14, 2009, Ted Bodie, Resident Sociologist and Chair, Department of English. Dear Ted, you've asked me to write a letter seconding the nomination of Franklin Cantrell for Payne's coveted Davidson Chair. I assume Cantrell is behind this request. No sane person would nominate a man whose only recent publications consist of personal genealogical material and who wears visible sock garters in class. All he lacks is a white tin basin to resemble a 19th-century barber. But if you want me to endorse his nomination in order to keep him quiet and away from your office, you will find him as persistent and maddening as a fly, You may excerpt the following sentences and affix my name to them. Professor Franklin Cantrell has a singular mind and a unique approach to the discipline. He is sui generis. The Davidson chair has never seen his like before.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.